All right, so today we're looking at entering his rest. Entering his rest through surrender. The greatest, one of the greatest things the Lord has taught me, other than repentance, is surrender. That's to me one of the major keys for entering his presence. So one of the things he's taught me is saying that the deeper the surrender, the greater the encounter. And that's what he said to me years ago. He said, if you can, basically he taught me, if you can surrender, the lower you go in the spirit, the higher you go. It's an inverted kingdom. So as you go down, you're actually going up. And I'll just give you something right up front, that if you can go down, because this is surrender is about humility. If you can go down and humble yourself, the demon cannot touch you. Do you know why? The demon can't humble itself. It's impossible for the devil to humble himself. Impossible. So the more you humble yourself, the more impervious you get to demons. They cannot touch you. They can attack you through people, whatever, say you, but it doesn't, it's just water that ducks back. A humble person doesn't get offended. It's just pride. Your pride gets offended. My pride gets offended because somebody stepped on my pride. And now you want to defend yourself because you're offended, and there you go. You know, the rest is history. And so we carry on like this. But and actually, one of the intercessors, and she saw the vision of the whole thing. When you humble yourself, the demon cannot get there, because you actually, what happens? You disappear. You come off the, you go off the radar. So if you want to become invisible, humble yourself. They can't get to you spiritually. They cannot touch you. All right, that's why they couldn't touch Jesus, because he was the most humble. And Moses as well was also at that time the most humble man on earth. And think what happened when he got attacked. His sister attacked him. What happened to her? She got a bit of leprosy. If you attack a humble person, you know what happens?
Backfire.
It's simple. God defends them. If you take a proud person, what are they? What happens?
They defend themselves,
because that's what pride does. But if you go for a humble person, they'll keep quiet. And then God says, that's not good. You know, if you push it too far, at a point, God will let you abuse a person so far, and then he says, stop. And then he says, now I'll sort you out. So, that's why he says, humble yourself, and the Lord will lift you up. Our daily surrender is the process of our daily death, burial, and resurrection. So when you surrender and you say, Lord, I surrender all, it's you acknowledging that you've been crucified with Christ. I've died. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. That's what you're doing every day. Every time you surrender, even if you do it 10 times a day, you're acknowledging your death. And when I say your death, I'm talking your old man has died. The flesh has died. You've been buried. And now you are resurrected with Christ, seated with him in heavenly places. So when you are surrendering, you're actually coming into position. The devil says, no, don't do that. He hates it when you surrender, because he's saying, you're weak. That's why God says, let the weak say they're strong. When you are acknowledging that you're weak, you're strong. When you're acknowledging you're strong, you're weak. You know, I've met people, some people, you can see they're very strong. And they'll tell you they're strong. And then I'll say, be careful now. You know, if someone's telling you how strong they are, I stay away from them. You know, if I can. You know, if you're not forced to work with them or something. But generally, a strong person is very dangerous. You know, because they are strong in their own strength. Not in the power of the Lord, but in their own pride. So, God says, let the weak say they are strong. Let the blind say, I can see. So if you don't say, if you don't acknowledge you're weak, then you won't receive the strength. If you don't say, I'm blind, you're never going to see. If you don't say, I'm a sinner, you'll never get saved. And Jesus says, I came to save the sick. I came to heal the sick. And the Pharisees saying, we're not sick. We don't need anything. You know, Abraham is our father. What do we need you? What do you need all this? He says, don't worry. You can't get any help. I can't help a person that doesn't need help. I can only help people who say, help me. Same thing for you. If you want to now evangelize, you call that helping people that don't want help. You can't help people that... I've heard a person who want to pray for an orange farmer. We were in the streets here one day ministering to people. I walked up and we met this guy who was in a wheelchair. I thought, oh, excellent. Now we can get him healed. He didn't think so. I said, would you like us to pray? God will heal you. He says, no, thanks. I said, what? You want to stay sick? Yeah, yeah. Why? He says, no, I'll lose my income. You know, I'm getting, he's getting like, you know, getting money from the government. If he gets healed, he has to work. Yeah. I said, different dimension. Oh, okay, sorry. Please, have your seat. Stay seated. I didn't even get challenged to get him out the seat. So it's like, that was the first time for me. Then, you know, your eyes are opening. You think, not everyone wants healing. And Jesus didn't go and heal everyone that was sick. But everyone that God sent him to was healed.
Yeah.
Everyone was instantly healed from whatever their sickness was and whatever demon they had, they were delivered. So God can deliver you instantly from any demon, any sickness, by the power of Jesus. Instantly. Okay? All right. So this, when we surrender, it's our daily acknowledgement and the practical outflow of the death, the burial, and the resurrection. So when we surrender, we by faith put off the old man. So when you're just saying, I surrender, you're putting off the old man. The old man with its deeds, the anger, the frustration, fear, doubt, unbelief is the old man. That's the old man. So when you surrender, saying, I'm surrendering to you, Lord, I'm putting off the old man, that carnal nature, that nature in you that wants to actually be so violent or aggressive or think evil of other people, judge other people, point fingers, all that stuff. Fear, 1001 fears that we have. All of that is the old man. It's the old nature. Okay? Jesus came to save us from the old man. And there's only one solution for the old man. There's only one solution. And that is death. It's the final solution. Okay?
Yeah.
Jesus had the final solution way before Hitler. He thought the final solution was kill the Jews. No. Jesus' final solution was everyone must die. But not die physically, die to the flesh. He says, deny yourself, take up your cross. This is deliverance 101. This is a deliverance 101 scripture. Deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. If you do that, you'll get delivered from every demon. You've got to dig into that. That little line, there's so much in that line. Paul understood that line, and because he understood that line and followed that line, we got the epistles and the letters of Paul. It came out of that one line. Because he said, if he's going to boast, he's going to boast in what? He's going to boast in the cross. He understood the cross. The cross still needs to be the central message. Because the cross says, I was crucified with him. You know? I was crucified with him, and that Jesus crucified my flesh. I was actually on that cross with Jesus. It says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Christ lives in me. When I acknowledge that I have been crucified, it empowers me. If I say I deny myself and take up my cross and follow him, it means I don't do my own will. Some people, Christians, think you can do whatever you want and God will follow you. My Bible doesn't say that. Some Christians think, whatever you do, God will bless it. No. No, that doesn't work. I tried that long ago. Jesus was at one point refused to follow me around anymore because I wasn't a baby. So when you grow up, he says, no, now you follow me, sonny boy. You know, it's like, you know, when you're younger, you go where you want. But when you're older, mature, you will go where you don't want to go. Jesus didn't want to go to the cross. He said, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. Even Jesus didn't want to do the will of the Father. So how much more will you not want to do God's will? That's why you need to pray before you go anywhere. That you're going to pray before you move house. Pray before you start a business. And you need to know if God says start a church or not. Just because you planted a church doesn't mean God did it. Lots of churches God didn't plant. Don't worry, he'll be wrecking them soon. They're going to be disappearing. Everything that God didn't plant is going to be just shake down. It's a shakedown. Everything that God didn't plant, it will fall. Everything that God didn't build will collapse. It's the great shaking that's happening now. So everything is shaking. And there's only one thing that never shakes. It's the kingdom of God. He says everything else will shake. But the kingdom of God never shakes. So that's Hebrews 12. So it's like, okay, everything is shaking. So now we start to surrender. And as you start to surrender, you're getting closer to the Lord. Your spirit is getting energized by the glory of God. Your flesh is getting put off. And you now put on, it says, put on the new man. What does the new man look like? Jesus. You're putting on love, joy. That's why every morning we sit here at the altar here. You know, we bow down, we kneel here, and we, with the children, we say, okay, now we're going to actually have the nine fruit. If you want to be fruitful, you need to eat fruit. Like love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, all the nine fruit. And you start to eat the fruit, and then get filled with the Holy Spirit. Daily, because you leak. You know what causes you to leak, right? Sin. Sin causes you to leak. And so you need to be washed because you get dirty, and you need to be filled. You need to be washed daily. So this is what God has taught me is how to get clean. How to get washed, how to get filled, how to get healed, how to get delivered, and how to eventually get to thanksgiving, praise, and worship. Because that's the problem. We start with praise and worship, and that's the wrong place to start. Sorry to just say that, but I believe it's the wrong place to start. People that are actually filthy. Let's just start singing songs to God. Let's see how clean you get. Meanwhile, most of those people, they stand in church like this. Have you watched them? Waiting for the sermon. And they don't like praise and worship. They think it's a waste of time because the people are singing songs. And now we've got to get entertainers so that you can really enjoy the entertainment before the service, which is now the word. So now we do this, what we call praise and worship, but actually it's more entertainment because we want to get the people like jiving a bit. You know? Come on, I've had them standing. So, okay, stand up now, clap your hands, I see you, do this, pump you up, but not, you know what? You can't get somebody in the spirit by telling them what to do. You only get someone in the spirit by when they humble themselves. So you're trying to tell people in a congregation now, all stand around, look like Donald. It doesn't work. You can forget it. The best thing you can do is say, okay, let's all repent. Let's all come and just lay down our burdens, lay down that sin, lay down your doubt, unbelief. Jesus loves you. Let's come to Jesus, and you lay it down, and suddenly they connect. They connect when they surrender. Okay. So I found that when I'm battling because I haven't surrendered. It is that simple. Surrender what? That thing that's in your head right now, that thing that's going around your head, that's blocking your prayer time with the Lord, that thing is what you haven't surrendered. And he says, then Miriam was struggling with this a while ago, and that was an excellent revelation she got. So if you're struggling to surrender, it's because you can't surrender. You can't surrender. And then the Holy Spirit says, but I'm here to help you. So did you ever ask the Holy Spirit to help you surrender directly? Like, Holy Spirit, help me. It works every time. Try it. Just try. Just ask Holy Spirit to help you to surrender when you can't. Because you get to a place when you can't. When you can't, you ask the Holy Spirit. In fact, what I'm doing now is I go straight to him and say, I can't anyway. Help me. And he goes much quicker. He's the helper, and he's not going to force himself on you most of the time. Okay? Most of the time. He's not going to just jump on you. I know people say he's a gentleman, but he's actually God. He's beyond a gentleman. So what happens is, because there was some violence, the Holy Spirit came in with a mighty blowing wind, and most gentlemen would be doing that, rocking the house and fire on the people's heads. So it was quite violent. People suddenly talking in tongues that didn't even actually want to. So what happens is he can take over, but generally he won't just push himself on you. Generally he won't do that. I wish he would do that with me. Okay, take over. I've got a problem. Please take over. I actually invite that kind of situation where the Holy Spirit just take over, possess me, be possessed with the Holy Spirit. So it's like, okay, so the Holy Spirit is like waiting for you, standing there every time you pray. I don't know exactly what he's thinking, but I'd be wondering at what point this person is going to ask me for help, because I'm the helper. My name is Helper. At what point do you say, help me? How often are you saying, Holy Spirit, help? How often do you say, I've been falling into the trap this week. You know what? I'd get on my computer trying to figure something out, work at it, frustrated, and it doesn't work. And then I'd actually ask the Holy Spirit, I'd ask, Lord, help me. Like this, I get an idea. And I'm thinking, yes, how stupid am I? It's not about stupidity. It's just how calm I am that I would not learn that I should always ask Him for everything, to help me in everything. Mm-hmm. Everything you tackle, if you just say, Lord, help me, He's there. But He said, look, you want to do it yourself? That's fine. Then you can get some of the glory. That's also not fine. But, you know, it's just generally we're trying to say, look, Dad, no hands. I can run a business. I can run a business. I can run a church. And then, pow, if God has mercy on you, He'll humble you. If He doesn't humble you, you're in big trouble. Because God chastises those He loves. Those that are not chastised are bastards. Okay, that's what the old King James says. You know what a bastard is. A person that doesn't know his father is. He did have some donor, but he doesn't know his dad. So we want to know our father, so He's going to chastise us. So guess what? He's going to chastise you how? He's going to chastise you through your business, your finances. Unfortunately, even sometimes He's going to allow sickness on your body, but you know, He hands you over to the tormentors if you don't forgive. All that kind of good love that God gives us. Because He's not Father Christmas. Some people think He's Father Christmas. They've got an image of God like Father Christmas. Sit on His lap, pull His beard and say, gimme, 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 my name's Jimmy. Thank you very much. I can do what I like. And just gimme. I'm here and I've gave my tithe. So it's like, you know, what is this? This is not like a casino here. Put your money in, three cherries, you win. Boom, thank you for He's not a casino. He's not a stop machine. Put your tithe in. Ching, 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 ching. Oh, yes. Oh, we got it. I got the luck. So God is very intentional about disciplining His children. Like I am very intentional about disciplining mine. He's very intent on disciplining you because He loves you. And He's not going to allow you to get away with what He allowed you to get away with 10 years ago. So if you are doing certain things, he might get on your case now and you suddenly wonder why things are going wrong. He says, no, I allowed you to do that. But no longer will you get away with that thing. I'm going to start disciplining you for that mouth of yours or whatever, those thoughts. Okay. And then we can't understand what's going wrong. And then the devil comes along and says, God doesn't love you. Look at this. What's happening with your life? You used to go so easy and just blessed and money and whatever. So now it's not working anymore like it used to. Guess what? It's called you are growing up. He's now teaching you like an adult. And He's saying, now I want you to love your father. In the past, you would just do whatever you want. Pray your prayer of faith and just get blessed. He says, no longer. You're going to walk like my son and you're going to love like my son and not just think about, you know, trust me for money. I want you to trust you. With me, He said, the number one priority is love, not faith. So, you know, faith, He dealt with me many years. And then I thought, well, basically, I've got faith now. I can get anything I want. He says, no. I gave you faith so you can get love. So if you want to trust God with something, it's the ability to love. If you really want a faith project, it's the ability to humble yourself. So, Lord, I believe, you know, like people go, write your vision. I believe that I can be like Christ. Apply your faith to that. More than I need a new car, I want a new house, I need $100,000 for this. Whatever. You know, it's a faith project. The faith project, the number one faith project for us is to become like Him. So let's trust Him. Okay, so it starts with surrender. He then comes, and the moment you humble yourself and you bow down, even physically, it helps even to bow down. Physically get out your chair. You can't start humbling yourself. It's not so easy to humble yourself slouching in your lounge chair with a cup of coffee in your hands. Okay? Seriously. Get on your face. Seriously. Just get on your face. Actually, bow your knees. You say, well, I can't bend my knees. Some people can't bend their knees. Their knees are sore. It's fine. Get on your face. Just lie on your face. On the carpet. See what happens.
Not on the bed.
No, on the bed you fall asleep. Get on the face on the floor. You will see what happens in your heart. Something happens because you're actually physically doing a manifestation. It's like some people say, I don't have to lift my hands when I praise the Lord. Mm. Have you seen those people? Mm. They stand in church like this. Mm. Fold their arms. Or some of them do this. They can't go higher than their shoulders. Yeah. So what happens is, it just shows you where the shoulders are because the hands can't go above their heads. Okay. Because something happens when you go above your head. He says lifting holy hands. The Bible said lifting holy hands. Doesn't the Bible say that we can kneel? We can bow? We can fall prostrate? Even in heaven, the 24 hours of falling prostrate before the throne. They say, geez, we get dirty on the floor. Or, you know, it's below us. You know, we are presidential people here. It's like presidents all getting on the floor, falling on their face at the United Nations. Ever seen that? Have you ever seen them get on their faces? It's beyond me to get so undignified. That's why that Jezebel spirit on David's wife was so was complaining, because he was getting undignified, dancing and half naked in public in front of the other woman. He's dancing before the Lord. He's not worrying about the woman. He's not doing some kind of a show here. He's dancing before the Lord and says, how can you do this? You're a king. You can't die like this in front of peasants. Well, why don't you try and get on your face? Kneel down. You know, like it's gone out of fashion, kneeling. Kneel down. Bow down. Okay, when it praise and worship, stand up. Not just sit down. Some people praise the Lord by sitting down. I said, no, get up. The Bible says, make a joyful noise. No, I'm a quiet person. Oh, is it? Well, God says, make a noise. You're a loud person. God says, keep quiet. For anything that you naturally are, God will tell you to do the opposite, to break it, to break that stronghold. Reese House, ever heard of Reese House? One of the greatest intercessors that ever lived. God told him to not wear a hat. Now, apparently in those days, not wearing hats like walking around without pants on. So it's like he was walking around naked, and God said, you're not going to wear a hat. Now, for a man or a gentleman not to wear a hat was like a major scandal. And God says, you're not putting it on. But that guy had some major impact on world events over the world wars. Because he had to obey God. But God told him to do things he didn't want to do. So God tells you to stand up when you want to sit down. He tells you to sit down when you want to stand up. Because he wants to break that selfishness in me that is limiting his spirit from flowing in me and through me. Okay. So that comes through surrender. So when we say, okay, I'm going to surrender, well, there's a divine exchange. So here's the good news. He doesn't want you to just lay it down. There's no vacuum in the spirit. When you lay something down before God, you know what happens? He gives you whatever he's got. So the moment you surrender your anger, what's God going to give you? Peace. Love. So when you put the anger down, you can grab his love. He gives you love. When I put fear down, he gives me love. He gives me faith. He gives me joy. So what happens? Everything I surrender, he gives me something in return much greater than what I put down. So what is the big issue of surrender? Why are we holding on to darkness? I'm talking fears, anxiety, stresses. Why is it so difficult? We find it so difficult not to worry. Because worry is sin, right? So we're worrying and I'm stressing about things. I'm stressing out. The money's going to come in. He says, give me the worry. He goes, yeah, Lord, it's so hard. Do you know I like this torment? It sucks. So nice. I just like to sweat. I like to have heart attacks. I like to get cancer. You know, 75% of sicknesses are psychosomatic. That means it's coming from your mind, your stress. Don't worry. You know, so it's like you're holding on to a snake that keeps biting you. And your father says, give me the snake. Yeah, he's mine now. Like a toddler. Mine, it means mine. It's mine. What, the snake? Yeah, it's my worry. It's like your sickness. You take ownership of the sickness. You even call it yours. No, it's my sickness. People talk about my sickness. They talk about this. It's like they've taken possession. So God's saying, you're possessed by darkness. Let it go. And you know why you can't let it go? One thing. The big P. Pride. Pride will stop you in your tracks and convince you that giving your worries to God is the wrong thing. Because after all, if you really worry about, if you really care for your children, you will worry about their safety. Yeah, I'm a good parent. How do you know? I worry a lot. What about my children's safety? Oh, excellent. Well done. You're doing so well. You're such a good parent. Worrying about your children. Yes, I worry all day. I worry about you. Don't you know? I care about you. If you don't do it, I'll strangle you. It's like, yeah, I can see you care a lot. If I don't do what you say, you're going to kill me. Yes. Oh, okay. I can see. There's so much love. No, there's so much fear in you that you're trying to control me, because if I'm out of control, I'm going to get into a pit. So this is about surrender. Because we're all control freaks. We want to control everything. The only control that's holy is self-control. Right, everything else is carnal. Okay, so this is the divine exchange. We give him our all, and he gives us his all. Doesn't get better than that. Isn't that awesome? Daily you pick up rubbish. You're walking around picking up cares, picking up, and you get dirty. Now God loves you. He's not doesn't love you less. He loves you the same. He says, "Can't you give me that? Don't worry. Why don't you give me your brother that hurt you? Why don't you give me your pain in your heart?" Yeah. So it starts with surrender, and then it continues, because now once you've surrendered, you can get filled. The problem with people, Christians, is they don't get filled with the Holy Spirit. They, look, once upon a time they were baptized in the Holy Spirit, but they basically leaked all out. They're just a carnal human being, Christian, going to church, filled with carnality, hanging on, going to church, getting a little drop, but they're not getting filled every day. And I need to be filled every day. Otherwise, Miriam's going to know about it. She knows about it when I'm not filled, because that carnal man is too strong. That carnal man is too strong for your soul. The carnal man is too strong for you. And the only one who is able to overcome this carnal man is Jesus and Holy Spirit. He overcame him. And you can only overcome your flesh through Jesus by taking up the cross and saying, "I deny this thing by the power of Jesus. I'm going to love my brother." Boom. By the power of God, I'm going to love you. By the power of God, I'm going to forgive you. But then you've also, now I've surrendered my will. I say, "I will love you." And pride says, "I won't love you. I withhold my love from you because you've abused me, hurt me, whatever." Now I'm withholding. It's all about one thing, surrender. Okay, surrender. So it is important to wait on the Lord and so that he can show you the specific areas that he wants you to surrender. Because we say this and we sing that awesome song, "I Surrender All." But actually, we don't really know what all means. Because we don't know what God, when we say all, God sees a different all to what we see all. All is, let's say, your 5%. God sees the 95% that you're holding on to. And then he'll come knocking at your door gently. He says, "You know that room that you haven't opened for years? You know, one of the skeletons? Knock, knock, knock. Nah, Lord, don't talk to me about that. Let me tell you about this. I want you to come into the finance room, Lord. I need some finance. Can't come into the room." He says, no, I want to go to that back room. You know that one with the mother-in-law in it? Or the father-in-law, or your cousin that hurt you, or your ex-wife. You know that back door? You know that back room? You know, you keep the skeletons there. I want you to actually open that door, and I want to talk to you about your ex-wife. Lord, I thought we'd done with that one. No, we haven't. We want some light on the subject. One, you got spiders, you got demons in there, and you wonder why you're sick. It's because you're harboring things there. Let's walk into that room. Let's open it up. Let's air it out. Open the curtains. Let some light in. This is surrender, because there are 8 rooms in your heart. There are 8 rooms in your life that you are 8 realms that you're dealing with, which I'm going to talk to you about now. And we need to surrender every single room, every single gate. And on top of this, with all of these gates, there are gods. And the gods are pride. So you've got 8 rooms, right? That deal with, let's say you've got the room of emotion. That's your emotional room. Oh, that's a very special room. That's only the room I'm allowed, me, myself, and I in that room. And that's my emotions. And don't mess with it because it's my feelings. Don't. And it's like, my feelings? I say, that's more like a demon feeling you. And you're feeling the demon, but you think it's your feeling. That depression is not yours. I mean, God never gave it to you. And I know he gives depression. So what are you sitting with depression for? It's my feelings. You can't understand. I feel this way. I said, really? And God told me, get delivered from those feelings, because those feelings are not from God. You've got to actually confess those feelings as sin. So God started telling me that your emotions need to be saved just as much as your head. Just as much as your mind, your emotions. Because soul, you know, it says that Romans 12. You will be transformed by what? The renewing of what? No. It doesn't say mind. Go read the word. The translation says mind, but it's the word for soul. I think it's psuch in Greek. Okay, it's the word soul. We know what the soul consists of. Mind, will, and emotions. So the problem is most people will try, actually I did this for years. I tried to reprogram my mind. I thought it was a computer. And I'd get the word in and I'd change. And I never did. I became more like a Pharisee because I got clever and clever. My head got bigger and bigger. I need more structures. But you know, my emotions wasn't changing. And I still was just as hard, actually became harder. And because I didn't realize that God wants to heal my emotions. I'm a man. I have emotions. Jesus is a man. He's got emotions. We are made in his image, not just women. And men kind of think emotions is like actually an ungodly thing or an unmanly thing. It's a complete abomination. God gave me emotion. So what happens is I say, God, come into my emotions. Heal my emotions. But for years, I closed that door because people hurt me in my emotions. I didn't have emotions. Most men won't admit they've got emotions, although they've got them. They will cut them off. But women, oh, they just cry. You know, they're very emotional. Women have got their emotions. But men, no, we're hard. We don't have emotions. And it's actually a bunch of baloney. So when God says, I want to come into your emotional room, you've got to say, okay, Lord, come into your emotional room. And guess what? It's going to be quite emotional. He's coming in with his emotions into your emotions, and there's going to be a bit of a story going on because suddenly there can be smoke and fire or tears and whatever when you suddenly allow Holy Spirit to come and comfort you because you need comfort. Okay, and that's when you've got to deal with your pain, not by yourself, but by the power of the Comforter, because his other name is Comforter. So we need the comfort of the Holy Spirit to heal our hearts, because we got people walking around with broken hearts that don't know how to get healed because they think they're going to get healed by listening to teachings. You're not going to get healed by listening to teachings. You're going to get guided by teachings, but the only way you're going to get healed is by allowing the healer to set you free in your own time. Sometimes in a service you can get set free. Praise God for that mercy. But most of the time I've got free. It's not in a service. It's me and God, and he's counseling me, and he's teaching me what I need to know. And he's taught me what I need to know. Sometimes he uses people. And most of the time he's talking direct. Tells me, this is what it said. This is what I say. And he's giving me revelation. And that revelation he gives you is what sets you free. And he teaches you when you're on your knees. But if you can't even surrender, he's not teaching. And this is the problem we're sitting with. We're sitting with a church, I'm generalizing, that doesn't pray. And a church that doesn't pray. When I say pray, I'm talking having intimacy with the Lord. We are sitting with a church that doesn't pray and doesn't know God. But they know the teachings of God. They know about him, but they don't know him. Israel, they didn't know the ways of God. They didn't know God like Moses did. But they knew his acts. They knew the works of God. They can recite them. They can quote them to you. This is what God did in the world. But they didn't know the ways of God. In other words, how does God really work? The footsteps of Jesus. How does he work? What is the nature of God? What is the heart of the Father? And that can only come by your time with the Lord. Your time with the Lord. That is what's called buying oil. The five wise Christians, I'm calling them Christians because they're all virgins, they're all Christians, were the ones that actually had the oil of intimacy, and the five foolish ones were the five Christians that never spent time with God because they were too busy. Okay, so God is saying, come aside and bow. Some people are too busy. And I get sometimes too busy. That's like nonsense. It's not. God told me the reason you don't pray and people don't pray is because they're trusting in their flesh. That's the number one reason. You don't pray. You know when you don't pray in the morning? It's you're trusting in yourself. That's as simple as that. And Jesus said, could you not watch 1 hour? I mean, it's interesting. He actually brought up the word time. Some people say, no, I chat him the whole day. I said, no, that's not intimacy. That's casual chat with the Lord. Intimacy, you don't tell your wife, I'm chatting with you all day. We're not having private time. It's like, what? Intimacy is different to having a chat in the car on the way to pick and pay. So please don't tell me you're intimate with the Lord because you're chatting every day. That's not intimacy. Okay? Intimacy is when it's just you and God and you shut the door. He says, shut the door, shut the door, shut the door, shut the door. He says, pray lest you enter into temptation, because the flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. And guess what? What did they do? All of them. They fell asleep. Why did they fall asleep? Do you know why they slept? Because they were sorrowful. And people that are sorrowful sleep it off. They're depressed people sleep. They didn't want Jesus to die. He just told them he's going to die. Go read it. It says they were sorrowful. And because of their sorrow, they slept. And Jesus just said, pray. And Peter just boasted he would never deny the Lord. Do you know why Peter denied the Lord? He didn't have a time of the Lord. He didn't actually have his hour of power. That day, he never prayed. Then, wakey wakey, the enemy's on your back. You don't have time to pray when the devil's busy breaking into your house. You don't have time now to read the word when he's breaking in. You need to know the word. You need to have the firepower. When he comes in, you whack him. And Peter didn't have the firepower to resist Satan, because he never prayed that day. The greatest day of his life, test of his life, he never prayed. But you don't know which is your greatest day. But Peter, Jesus gave him a heads up. He was busy sweating blood on his knees, praying, not my will. Doesn't that sound like surrender? That Jesus, God in the flesh, was tempted not to do his Father's will. So if he's tempted not to do God's will, do you think you're not going to be tempted? The number one thing that Christians battle with, other than prayer, is God's will. Talk to them about God's will, they run away, because they think God's will is terrible. No, don't do this God's will thing yet. No, I'm okay. I'm fine. Don't go do the God's will. God's will is awesome, but it's painful. And that's why you have to take your cross, and it says narrow is the way. Why? Narrow is the way for who? Narrow is the way for a disciple. Wide is the way for any believer. You can go anywhere you want and just ask God to follow you. But don't worry, he doesn't have to follow you. He's already there. But Jesus said, follow me. And he's only in one place at one time for you. Look, he's everywhere. He's omnipresent. But if he says, follow me, he says, I am leading you somewhere you don't want to go. Until you realize that, you don't understand what it means to be a disciple. Because he told Peter, when you're younger, you go, you went where you wanted to go, but when you're older, you will not. You'll be carried where you do not want to go. And he was signifying the way he was going to die. Peter didn't want to die on a cross upside down. Jesus didn't want to die on a cross naked. All those disciples were not trying to get killed. And every one of them had to, as they matured, had to actually live a more very focused life as they grew up. And so when you're younger, yes, you could do a lot of things as a Christian. But when you're older, God's going to close in on you and say, right, now, you need to grow up. You need to start to follow me. You need to pray before you go anyway. Don't just go. Okay. All right. So this is the surrender. And so when we surrender, we're surrendering the eight rooms of the heart. So I'm just going to go through the eight rooms of the heart with you, because it's important that you actually surrender these areas in your life. Some areas you might be surrendering, some you might not. It might give you something you haven't thought about, some areas you haven't thought about. But these are the main areas in our lives. The gates represent our will. Okay, so there's a gate, that's the government. The gates are the government. So if you've got a room and a door, that's your will. You decide who goes in and out. The guard outside is pride, and that's self, protecting that room. Your finance room. That's why some people don't give, or they don't tithe or anything, because pride says no. We don't do this in this house. Just like that. I mean, they can hear it 100 times. It's just not going to do it. And fear and everything else. So each room has a gate and a throne. So imagine this. You've got a room of finance, and there's a throne in it. And guess who's sitting on the throne? Huh? Well, it's going to be self. And guess who rules self? Satan. You must know, if self is in control, there's someone in control of self, and that's the devil. So you must know, self can never overrule the devil, because he's now the most selfish. So if yourself is on the throne, the devil can pull your chain anytime he wants. And that's why Jesus, when he goes to deliverance ministry, he just says, deny self. Doesn't come with all our nonsense, paraphernalia, teachings that we got today about how to get delivered. He just says, deny self. It's like, what? He knows something about self that we don't know. Paul got more revelation if you just look up the word self. Okay, so self is sitting on a throne, controlled by a demon of fear, of your finances, which is now right under mammon. Okay, so you've got mammon sitting in your financial room calling the shots. So that basically means you have fear of losing your money. You might have a bit of greed, a bit of stealing, you know, just like legal stealing. Just, you know, you wouldn't call it stealing. You call it something else, pirating or something. But anyway, you got a bit of stealing in the finances. So you got, you know, pirated software, pirated CDs, pirated whatever. So you got, you're a pirate. You're just a pirate for Jesus. So it's like, don't worry. I steal from the rich, give it to the poor. God doesn't go with that Robin Hood stuff. So it's like, you know, so we'll justify our stealing. Okay? Stealing taxes. We've got all different ways of stealing. So we've got that room, finances. We got self on top there. We think we're ruling, but darkness is calling the shots because we just submitting to the devil. When he tempts you, you submit. And then we go to church and we're giving finances and we're giving tithes. And God says, your finances are still not in my hands because you're still ruling your money. All right, so will you surrender the whole financial room to me? Could take you 5 years to do that. 10 years, sometimes never. Some people don't even know they've got a financial room. So God's saying, I want to take over the whole financial room. I want to put my light in it. I put my word in it. I put my scriptures in it. I want to sit on that throne, in that room. In fact, he wants to sit on 8 thrones. He wants to sit in every single area of your life as Lord and Savior. But the problem is we just want Savior, but not Lord. Lord, you follow and obey. Savior, he saves you from your problems. So we want Savior Jesus, but not Lord Jesus. So Lord Jesus comes knocking and says, I want to be Lord. You say, you saved me years ago. I'm free. I'm free to do what I want. Really? You didn't hear the Lord part. You know, when we get saved, we say Lord Jesus, not Jesus. So Jesus means Savior. So we've got to get, you know, Lord in front of Savior. So it's like, Lord Jesus, we salute, and he says, now I want to come into your room. So we've got to surrender the keys and say, okay, first of all, we've got to disarm this guard in front of your room. It's called pride. And this works with any room like this. You've got to disarm the guard of pride. How do you disarm the guard of pride? Humble yourself. Surrender. Start surrendering. He's got no answer for surrender. The devil got no answer for that. You completely disarm him when you humble yourself. Demons are completely disarmed with humility. They have no answer to humility. Their answer to humility is pride. Or false humility, which is pride. So now you humble yourself, that demon is powerless. Jesus walks into the room, he says, right. And he starts to give you words, scriptures. And you say, Lord, but this one stole from me. He says, forgive them. And this one hasn't paid me for 5 years. They still owe me like 5,000 rand. He says, forgive them their debts as I forgive you yours. What do you mean? They mustn't pay back? No, forgive them. You mean they mustn't pay back? No, forgive them. You mean I can't sue them? No, forgive them. Don't you know what forgiving debts means? You mean they mustn't pay back? That's it. Yeah, don't get the money back. You mean that I mustn't remind them every week? No, give them the money. Oh, 40,000 rand, yeah, 50,000. Yes, forgive them. Okay, so that might be very hard for you. But you're tithing, and your tithing ain't working because you actually haven't forgiven the debts. That's just one area. I'm not going into financial teaching now because you need Jesus, the teacher, to give you a financial training. And there's more scriptures than Malachi 3 in the Bible on finances, like 2,300 of them. If you want to know how many scriptures on money. All right, so if you think you know everything about money, I don't know all those 2,000 scriptures, but I've got a book with them, all 2,300 of them. All right, so the Lord wants to rule every single room, but he's not going to force himself as Lord. You have to say, Lord, come in. Lift up your heads, O you gates, that the King of Glory will come in. Into where? Into your gates. Lift up your heads. Are you gates? What's the gates? Your will. You're aware of your finances. Hey, but you know what? Maybe you've done the financial surrender and you blessed financially. It's fantastic. But you know what? You've got 7 more rooms you can look at. So don't worry. You can be okay now. Now we'll get off the financial room and we'll look at the most difficult room is the belief system room. The belief system is your thoughts. And basically, it's everything you believe, both true and false, is what you believe is right. Right or wrong. It's your belief system. You believe these certain things. When people, when I counsel people, I just listen to their mouth. And I just judge it with a sword. So some people think I'm very hard. I just take a sword, and the sword is the word, and I just let it come. And there's a... And then you can discern. You discern. This is darkness and this is light. And people will talk darkness and light in the same voice, the same time. It's like, wow. Okay, that one's wrong. That's okay. That's okay. Let's put all that there. That's the darkness. Let's deal with the darkness. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So that's how I know what's in your heart. Out of your mouth it comes. So when we deal with the heart, you just let that person talk for 5 minutes. Boop. Their heart pops out on the floor. How dirty it is, whatever. All right. Okay. You want to say something more? Okay, carry on. Talk. Talk. Your heart's just coming out your mouth. You can't hide it because the light will tell you exactly what's cooking with that thing. So the problem is now when you want to do operation. Because the light cuts and the light divides. So this includes my eternal plan, my purpose, my responsibilities, and my own self-righteousness. That's your belief room. Okay, so you need to surrender the room and say, Lord, my belief systems need to be your belief systems. Can you please sort that out? You can have an earthquake at that point. You can have an earthquake in your life. Just think what's happened to you. I mean, Andrew, I mean, in the last like a year or 8 months, the earthquake that's happened in you, but the freedom that you're getting is because you allowed him in that room. Your belief system was your most difficult room. Because he was so knowledgeable in the word, and I was so know, he says, no, let me in that room. Oh, Lord, you know, I know the scriptures. Really? Okay, let the scripture walk into your room, then you'll see how you know the scriptures. He says, you might know the scriptures, but you don't know the truth. The truth is different from your interpretation of the scriptures. I'm not interested, God's not interested in your interpretation of scriptures. Neither am I. Anyone, but God is saying that scripture means. And that only comes by the spirit of revelation. Not your study of the scriptures. And now I went and studied this book and I got this opinion and this rabbi's opinion. I said, who cares about all these opinions? I said, what is the Lord saying? And does it set you free? Because he says, if you know the truth, it will set you free. If you're getting scriptures, you're not getting more free. You're not getting the truth. You're getting knowledge and you're getting puffed up. I did that for years. I got so much knowledge. I got more and more puffed up, more in bondage, studying the word, just like the Pharisees. Can you imagine? They studied the scriptures their whole life. They could quote half the Bible or the whole Bible. The scripture walks in Jesus, who is the word. And they start rebuking him. How blind can you be? The Bible walks in the flesh, and now you start challenging him on doctrine. It's like, you're going to teach God doctrine? And every time they try to get clever, he asked them questions they couldn't answer. It's like brilliant. It's like, what's this one? Should we pay our taxes to Caesar? Bring me the money. Whose image is this? Caesar. Give to Caesar what is Caesar. Shut them up. Whoa. I mean, brilliant. Brilliant. Every time he did it, it's like, you know, like now, remember, and Jesus was listening to the Father. So the Father was sitting there smiling. They're going to try and catch, the children are playing chess with Dad today. They're going to outmaneuver me. In my world, did I write? Now they're going to now get clever. And every time, he's like, bam, amazing. They had no answer. And then remember about the baptism. They challenged him about the baptism. John's baptism. They were challenging his authority, and he said, John's baptism, was it from God or from man? And they shut up as they knew. They could see the next move was checkmate. And they walked away because they knew they were in trouble. Whatever they answered, they were in trouble. Because they knew the people, they feared the people. And so they were blocked. And they walked away. Oh, we better start thinking of another question to ask. That's what Pharisees do. They'll come back to you more and more questions. All right, anyway. So then the next gate is the motive gate. Have you ever dealt with that one?
No.
Do you know how the root issue that? That is your root. That is serious roots. Your motive for doing what you do is the most important thing. Do you know that? It's not just the what you do. It's the why. And it's also the how. But let's just deal with the why you're doing it. It's your motive. Why are you doing this thing for this person? Is it to please the Lord or to please yourself? Is it to do something? Motive. Oh, no. I don't even. That's a door. Oh, that's a painful one. Because when God shows you your motive, you're going to get on the floor and repent. Because you can be doing ministry out of the wrong motive for years. And God says there's no reward for that because you did it at the wrong motive. Motive. So you go there and say, come and bring your light into the motive. And remember, there's no condemnation. Light doesn't condemn. It convicts. It cuts. And it brings freedom if you receive it. Okay? So all you've got to do is say, Lord, come in and set me free. I know I've got evil motives. I've got selfish motives. Believe it. You've got selfish motives. Just say it. I've got selfish motives. Jesus set me free. He says, do you really want freedom? Let me show you. Okay, you really want to love your wife unconditionally? You mean it's not like I love her, I want a bit back? You know, some people even talk to teachers in the church. It's like, you know, if you want your wife to treat you nicely, you've got to kind of soft sofa and be nice. Happy wife, happy life. What is that nonsense? Seriously. Now, where did Jesus teach that? Does Jesus do that? I don't know. I'm going to make the bride happy. The church must be happy, otherwise I'm not going to be happy. I mean, just look at the bride and Jesus. Like, does Jesus work like this? Don't worry, I'll just pamper you and so I can get sex later. What is that called? It's called seduction. Do you think Jesus does seduction with his bride? The first place he takes his bride after you just got saved is the wilderness. How romantic. He didn't take you to his palace. Say, what kind of husband is this? Where's he taking me? The desert with the cockroaches and the scorpions and the snakes. She says, no, just testing to see if you really love me. Stick around for a few years and we'll come out on the other side. If you don't love me, you go back to Egypt. Because you don't really love me. You love the money, honey. You love the blessings. And the fame and the fortune that the pastor told you you're going to get if you come to me. Come to Jesus. Solve all your problems. Really? Is that why you came to Jesus? And so what happens now is the Lord wants to set us free from the selfishness. But look, that happens when you get more mature. You can't tell us now to a baby Christian because they just collapse. You say, all right, now what happens is allow the Lord into your motive room and say, Lord, cleanse my motives. And then he will. And then the next room is the spirit gate, okay, which is the room into your spirit. This is the room where he dwells. That's the room that he's actually, and that, how do you allow him in? You pray in tongues. You just ask him to fill your spirit, not just your soul, but your spirit, okay, because your spirit needs to be fed with the word of God. That's the easiest room. The other room is your body room, the body gate and your room. That's your health, your immune system, each part of your body, your senses. This includes your eye and your ear gates. Have you ever tried to just surrender those to the Lord? Okay, so that's your health, but it's also your eye gates, your ear gates. So you can see how long this could take you. If you just started to work through it, so then it could be an hour and you wouldn't even touch. You might just do one room. But so it's impossible to go through everything. You cannot go through everything here in one shot. You just ask the Lord and say, okay, what room do you want to deal with? I want to surrender all rooms, but I know we just don't have time. But if you go away for a week and spend with the Lord, then you can do a lot of work on it.
A room a day.
A room a day, yeah. Can't spend a room a day. Say, Lord, we're doing the room. And he says, And so what happens is God, the next room is relationships. That's an interesting room. That's always a good test. So you guys let him into, now relationships, you know what that is? Every relationship you have with him, obviously, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, your relationship on earth with your enemies, you've got a relationship with them. And your friends and your family and everyone. Okay, so that's very important. Your neighbors, your associates, everyone. You've got so that's the relationship. The other one is the what I call the material room, which we call the financial room, but it's a material room because that's your bank accounts, your investments, everything is in that room. Businesses, debts, assets, your furniture. So I just basically call it the material room. That's where all the material is. Physical material in your life. And the eighth room is the circumstances. So the circumstances is everything you're dealing with, God wants you to surrender to Him. And that's one of the rooms we battle with a lot because we're dealing with situations in the world. We're dealing with violence. We're dealing with everything. And God wants you to surrender that room over to Him. That's your circumstances. So as you can see, there's a lot of rooms. There's not too many rooms. There's 8 rooms, but there's a lot of work to be done. And only the Lord...
Keep you busy for a while.
Keeps you busy. But like I said, you can't do all the rooms. Just say, Lord, I want to surrender my rooms. I surrender my heart. Teach me how to surrender. Because He wants to come to every single room and bring His light. And that's really what He wants you to allow Him to do. So it's really up to you. And He's waiting for you. So all you've got to do is just say, Lord, teach me how to surrender. Teach me how to humble myself. Come to You daily and surrender everything to You. So we thank You, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank You, Father, that You help us surrender. Everyone that's listening to this message, I pray that You'll help each one of us to surrender in Jesus' name.